So we had seen the calculations and how to introduce informal proofs instead of the calculations. So in calculations we found a difficulty in using the deduction theorem and deductio ad absurdum inside the proofs. Okay, so they had to be put as sub calculations inside a calculation. That's what we wanted to avoid, though this can be done. Then we introduced informal proofs. But informal proofs also have some limitation, like they go only for the consequence relation, they do not show equivalence directly. So if you want to show P if and only if Q, then you have to show two consequences, P entails Q and Q entails P, right. Nonetheless, let us use it. So the fifth one we are discussing last time, it is this. So it is also customary to start one informal proof by first listing all the premises, then whenever you want you use them, right. That is not always followed, but it is custom. So let us try with that. Say we will have one informal proof in this manner, first list all the premises. So include P as the documentation part. So these are all the premises. So there ends our premises, fine. Then we have to go for the conclusion. Now when we see that the conclusion is in the form of an implication, we are going to use the deduction theorem. So that means we take its antecedent, which is P and R, as an extra hypothesis or extra premise, and we document it as deduction theorem begins, fine. So we start with the seventh line as P and R, which will be writing as deduction theorem begins, right. Then our aim is to prove that not of W implies V. So there is a way here, you can start with reductio ad absurdum because it is in the not form, which you are not going to use it. So you may start with W implies V in the beginning as another extra premise, or there is another alternative. You may think of proving this by first proving its equivalence, which is W and not V. Not of W implies V is equivalent to W and not V. So you may proceed by getting W and then not V, then bring it to W and not V, then not of W implies V. That is one alternative. Another is use the reductio ad absurdum. So we will start using reductio ad absurdum here because we want to show how the nesting is done in the loops in application of this meta theorems. So let us take W implies V as the next extra premise. So we say 8, which is W implies V. So here we have to write reductio ad absurdum begins, okay. Then what is your strategy? How do you get a contradiction? So it is starting from P, this is also starting from R, and we have P and R. So we start with concluding P from P and R, similarly R from P and R, then apply these two premises and modus ponens, okay. So let us take P, this follows from 7. So you are using P and R entails P, that is your elimination, law of elimination. Or if you do not remember the laws, there is another alternative, but be aware of bluffing there. You may just write T for tautology, we know that this is already done, right. So only when you are experienced and you do not want to bluff, you can say, well, I know this as a theorem, I do not know what its name is, so you just write T. Okay. It is really the law of elimination, P and R entails P. That is what you are using. Then our plan is to use this P along with P implies not Q, and use modus ponens, right. So, that gives you not Q from line 1, line 9, and modus ponens. Even if you do not remember modus ponens, so you are allowed, write T, okay. Now, then what we want to do? Try to see wherever Q appears. So, it is in the third line, not T implies Q, and you have not Q. So, you can use modus tollens, right. It will give not of not of T, right. So, that gives not not T by using line 3, 3, 10, T. Again, modus tollens, if you do not remember the name, just write T, fine. So, now not not T, first let us bring it to T using double negation. Now, you have a nice formula, double negation you do not remember, so write T, okay. Then what is our plan? Here there is modus ponens we can use. So, that will give us not V from line 5, 12 modus ponens, okay. Next, how to use not V? Well, you can use here again modus tollens, yeah. So, 14 gives not W, and we are using from 8, 8, 13 modus tollens. Next, can go to this, okay. So, that gives not not U using 6, 14 modus tollens. So, let us bring it to better form. So, U double negation. Next, we have got U. So, again this is appearing here. So, 17 is not S, that comes from 4, 16 modus tollens, 2, that gives not R, same way, 2, 17 modus tollens. Next, from 7, P and R will give us R, that would give us a contradiction. So, write 19 R, that comes from 7 elimination, right. We have got R, we have got not R, therefore, bottom. Now, the problem is, this is not complete because you have taken two extra assumptions, fine. One is P and R, another is W implies V. So, where does that end? You have taken one extra assumption here, P and R. You have also taken another extra assumption, W implies V. Where do they end? Yes? Well, anywhere you could have ended. This requires your premise P and R, 7 is being there. Beyond that, there is no 7. So, there itself you could have stopped and tell that P and R implies the other things, right. But it is easier to end it here itself, okay. So, here you may say which one to end first? This is the inside loop, right. So, you write R A A E, that ends here, okay. So, when that ends here, what do you get? Let us write 21 over the other side. So, what do you get there? when you end array, array starts with the premise W implies V, right. So, we will be writing W implies V, its negation, because assuming W implies V gives you a contradiction. So, its negation must be valid, right. So, we will be writing not of W implies V, ok. So, there only you have to write R A E, not here, because that is what you are concluding. After you see that top is over or bottom you have reached, it is unsatisfiable. By applying the RAA, you are obtaining that not of W implies V, right. So, documentation should not be here, documentation should be over there. We should write RAA E over here instead of on line 20, ok. Now, once you come to RAE, that means the conditionality of W implies V, that premise is removed. Now, you do not have this assumption in the proof, that is what reductio ad absurdum says, fine. But still there is another conditionality, which is P and R. So, by deduction theorem you would conclude that W implies V has been obtained, its negation has been obtained by assuming P and R. So, P and R implies negation of that. Is it clear? There you are using the deduction theorem. So, P and R implies not of W implies V. Here ends deduction theorem. And you can also document the line numbers, like you are getting this RA due to 7th line, 8th line and 19th line, right. So, here you can document as 8, 19 RAE, ok, 8 and 20, because on 20th only you are getting a contradiction, fine. Similarly, for DT you will be getting 21, you are getting as a conclusion, and when it starts at 7th one. So, you document it as 7 20 dt, right, 21, there ends the proof. Is it clear? Ok. So, let us see the fourth problem, that should be easier. So, that problem says we go for P implies Q implies R, S implies not P, not S and T implies Q, that should give us T implies R. Okay. So, here again your strategy says if you use deduction theorem, assume T infer R, fine. If you want to use reductio ad absurdum, you start with not of T implies R, that will give you T, that will also give you not R, right. So, that is same thing as telling entails T as an extra premise concluding R, and after that using the reductio ad absurdum, T then not R also, and then introduce a or infer one contradiction, fine. But here it may be possible to get R directly without going to RA. So, let us see that. So, we start with the premises first. P implies Q implies R is a premise, S implies not P is a premise, not S and T implies Q is a premise. Now, comes the extra premise because of deduction theorem. So, we say T, deduction theorem begins. Okay. Our aim is to get R, fine. So, how to get R? We can get if we prove P implies Q, okay. But how to prove P implies Q? Use deduction theorem, assume P in for q, right. So, you take another extra hypothesis as p, you say deduction theorem again begins, but then there is problem. So, you take 1 here, 2 here. So, the loop for deduction theorem 2 should be inside that of 1, that is our idea here, fine. So, now p is an extra premise, how do we proceed? Yes. Why do we begin with p? We want to show r, right. Now, we have a premise, we says p implies q implies r. So, if you can prove p implies q by one application of modus ponens, it is done. Now, how to prove p implies q? By deduction theorem, I can assume p and deduce q, that is what I am doing, right. So, it is a sub proof inside the proof. Now, that is possible because of this looping and nesting, ok. So, now once we assume p, what should we do next? Yes, we can use this
2 and right. 5.
So, 6 gives not s, because 2, 5 modus tollens, right. So, we have not s, we have t, right. So, we will write here. Seventh line gives us not s and t first, not q directly, right. So, that is again introduction. If you have a premise as x, premise as y, then you can infer x and y, ok. That is introduction of and. So, we go for not s and t, and that is inferred from lines 4 and 6 by law of introduction. So, we are free to use t now. Yes, any problem? Ok. Next, we our plan is to use this third one. So, we get q from 3, 7 and modus ponens. See, our aim was to prove p implies q. We have assumed p in the fifth line, got q. So, first let us go to p implies q, there deduction theorem application or second application will end. So, we write 9 as p implies q and document as that premise was introduced in 5, line 5. So, 5, 8 deduction theorem ends here, its second instance. Is that ok? So, by writing this, conditionality of p is removed. We have no more assumed p because of deduction theorem. So, p implies q is deduced from our premises, fine. And possibly the extra assumption DTB1, we do not know that, right. But now we can use all the premises anywhere. So, our plan was to use this 10th. So, that gives us R, that is from line 1, line 9 modus ponens, ok. Is that right? Okay. So, we have got R, still there is a conditionality here that has not ended, ok. So, that assumption was T, therefore, we get T implies R. Which line was it? Fourth line. So, we write 4, 10 and DTE 1, is it clear? So, advantage is we can read the proof easily, what is happening inside the proof, that is very clear. And you can see the construction also, how we do we proceed thinking towards the proof, that whole thought process is decoded or encoded here, while reading it you have to decode it, is it clear? So these informal proofs and the equivalences or the calculations can be used for many other purposes, not only for proving. See, in usual practical problems, it doesn't come with symbolization. You have to understand and symbolize it. So that requires something more, just like your mathematical modeling. Just by knowing some differential equations, you may not be able to solve practical problems. You have to understand what is their meaning, how they are connected, and how to model it. The same way, in propositional logic, we are concerned with the connectives. So you must know what are the meanings of connectives used in the natural languages. Okay, and is used as and, there is no problem. Or is used as or, there is no problem. Implies used as if then also, if something then something. So you have to write it as implies. Sometimes you will write Q provided that P, so you know it is P implies Q. Okay, some similar concerns will be required, but there are some connectives which will be difficult to decode. For example, unless. How do you go about it? You say P unless Q. When you say P unless Q, P if not Q. Okay, P if not Q. That is your first translation. P if not Q. Okay, so let's write it that way. P if not Q. So which is simply not Q implies P. Right. Now what happens? If you use the equivalences, not Q implies P will be equivalent to not of not Q or P, right? Because we know X implies Y is equivalent to not X or Y. See, this is true when X is false or Y is true. Okay. These are the only cases when this becomes true. So it should be equivalent to not X or Y, right? So now once you apply, you get this, which is simply P or Q. So unless becomes simply or in our language of propositional logic. Now what about until? No, see, until and unless, they are same, because there is no time in propositional logic, right? There is no concern for time in propositional logic, so time is simply omitted, and we can't really correctly symbolize until, because you don't have the concept of time there. So it will be simply interpreted as unless, and that is R. It will not be correct when you apply in the programming scenario. There you have to go for another logic. Propositional logic is not completely adequate there. But at best, which can be done is until will be approximated as unless, which will again be symbolized as or. Is it clear? Sometimes in natural languages, problems do not come as problems, they will come as stories. Then you have to decode it correctly. For example, if you have read Merchant of Venice, you would have got nice problems. Have you read? So it's a heroine Portia. She says that among all my suitors, I'll choose the one who passes my test. So the test is this. She takes three caskets: one gold casket, one silver casket, one lead casket. So in one of the caskets only, she puts her portrait. And then locks them. On each of the caskets, she writes one sentence. Let's call it inscription. So now she brings all these three boxes in front of the suitors, and then she declares that you read the inscriptions written on the caskets, and I guarantee that it may not be true. The inscriptions may not be true. Now from that, you have to find out where the portrait is, right? So now she gives the boxes. On the gold box, something is written. Let us say the inscription is, "The portrait is here." and on the silver casket it is written, the portrait is in here. Now you see all of them cannot be true together, right. And on the lead casket it is written, at least two of the caskets bear false inscriptions. Okay. Now it's a real logical task. Something, some solution will come. There may not be solution, we don't know. She might have lied completely. Because she is fond of that. Okay, informally what you can do is start looking at these caskets where the portrait may be. Is it consistent? Right? So if you put in the lead casket, then what happens? Suppose the portrait is in the lead casket. So this is false. This is false. At least two inscriptions are false. It is consistent, right? It is a possible solution. Okay. If you put inside the gold casket, what happens? G is true, S is false. What about L? Is true or false? If it is true, if it is true, then at least two of them should have been false, but two of them are becoming true. Therefore, it has to be false, right? If it is false, then what happens?
Two of them are false.
At least two of them are false is false. So at most one of them can be false, right? So this is already false. The other one cannot be. Is that okay? So it is not consistent in G. The same way in S also it will not be consistent. It doesn't matter whether G or S. Inscriptions are the same. Okay. So it is in L because that is the only consistent one we are finding. But this is the informal one. Now how to formalize it? The problem is to formalize and prove really. Okay. Yes. So declared it. And not only at least one of them, it is in one of them.
Be there in G, then it should also be in S because they are in no way different.
Possible, so but that is no formalization in professional logic. Right? That's correct. That's so how we went to lead.
Yeah.
That's how we went to lead. Okay, let's try. Let's try this one. Suppose I write G, capital G, for the inscription that is written on the gold box, gold casket. It is the inscription which is written on the gold casket. So that means G will be the portrait is in here, that sentence itself, right, as it is written. Then same way I write capital S for the inscription written on the silver casket. So it is this. Okay. So in fact when you say in here, here is really confusing. So you have to change the inscription this way when you interpret. We have to say that the portrait is in the gold casket, right, not only here. That is the inscription. That is the way we have to read G, right. So G becomes the portrait is in gold casket. Similarly, capital S stands for the portrait is in silver casket. Okay, capital L stands for the inscription on the lead, which is this itself. Fine. Let's introduce some more propositional variables. Small g. What should be small g? For something else, I am writing related to the gold casket.
Not g. Not g and
See, one is the inscription you are writing. The portrait is in gold casket. That is the inscription. But where is the portrait? You don't know. That may be true or false. It is given. So let's write small g means the portrait is in gold casket. Right? It is not the inscription. Where is the portrait? For that we are symbolizing. Okay? So this g is this inscription itself. You may write a quote for that. Okay. So now small g will be the portrait is in gold casket. Right. So capital G is for the inscription written on the gold casket. Small g is for the portrait is in the gold casket. Okay. Now small s for the portrait is in silver casket. Next, small l for the portrait is in lead casket. Fine. Now these are all propositional variables. Now what are the premises given? Yes.
Small l is top.
It is in one of the caskets. Exactly in one of the caskets.
And I mean G and S.
G
and L and S and L are.
Or S or L.
G S.
Not of G and S.
If it is in one of them, it is not in the others.
Yeah.
Right. So let's say G implies not S and not L. Okay. Similarly, S implies not G and not L. Is that okay? Next, L implies not G and not S. It is in exactly one of the caskets. Next, what are the other premises? Yeah, capital
L implies not G and not S.
Capital L. If L is true, then at least two of them we are false inscriptions. That is true. Fine. So that means G has to be false. The other inscription G has to be false. The other inscription S has to be false. So this says not G and not S. If L is false, then so it says at most one of the inscriptions can be false. Already L is false. Therefore, other two must be true. Is that okay?
G and S.
Any other premise?
Capital G implies small g. Capital S implies small g.
Why implies? If and only.
Oh, okay.
Suppose the inscription which is written on gold casket is true. That means the portrait is in here is true. So small g is true and conversely, right. So we have g if and only if small g, s if and only if small s. Okay. And our hypothesis is, our guess is, it should give us L. This is consistent, that is what we have found out by informal arguments. Now, you have to show that really it entails L. Okay, Porcia is not irrational. Is that okay? Now, how to go about it? How to prove this? There are so many, but so many may not be relevant. So, first thing is look at this capital G, capital S, small s. Since these two are premises, we don't need to consider all those capitals and smalls. Is that okay? For G and S. So instead of this capital G and S, we could have taken small g and s also. That is our first observation. Okay? Where else? Here also we could have taken. but we are not able to think about L and small l. Is it? We do not know. It doesn't say the portrait is in here. It says something else. Right? Those two we could do because they are the same sentences here. But for L, sentences are different. Fine. So let's do that first. So once we do it, instead of this one, we would have gone for G and S. Then, instead of this, we would have gone for not G and not S. We do not need the last two now, it is done. Okay. Now, how do we prove L from this? Where from should we start? So, once you want to prove small l, where from it will follow? You have to check that. Where from it will follow? Small l. G? G and S. G and S will give what? Not G and not S.
Not of G and S will give L.
Not?
Not of G and S.
Not of G and S is where? Here. That will give capital L. G or from this place, can you get G or S? But G or S, see, this is not of G or S, De Morgan. So if you say G or S, then it will say not L, right, by contraposition. So, you have to see that does not happen, right. No, now you go back. So, once it is in L, it is not in G and it is not in S. But if it is not in G, it is not in S, then where is it? It is also in L, right. So, you should have. Is it okay? This is what you have missed. Of course, it will follow from this. Once you have this, that will also follow. Similar way, you could have got your stronger premises. Fine. So now to prove L, you simply go for not G and not S. If you can show that, that is enough. Now to give not G and not S, somewhere here or here. Where to show? Which extra premise?
Not L, not of capital L, show that it is a conflict.
Not of L. Okay. So, suppose you start with not L, then we get G and S, right? Then G and S gives what?
G and S
both
are
true.
Yes.
But that cannot be possible.
That gives not small
g,
S.
Also.
G gives not S.
No. So, G and S. His argument is G and S is not possible.
Yeah, G and S gives not S.
Not L.
Where it is not possible, we have shown?
G implies not S and not L.
So, no, you have G and S. He says it is not possible. That is clear from the context also. Is it formalized anywhere?
G and S will give not L, not small L.
G and S will give us G or S, right? By modus ponens, it will give us not L.
Not
this not L. Then?
So, no, not G and not S.
No, do not use that. You go the other way. Not L gives G and S. Right? Now, G and S gives?
Not small s itself, so it's
contradiction. G
and
S gives?
Not S.
Not S?
Yeah.
How?
G gives not S.
Not S.
G implies not S and not S.
So?
So it is not.
Not S and S.
So not L is not possible by RAS.
That gives the contradiction. Is it okay?
So it is L.
Is it okay? So now where should we start? Okay. Not L. So, deduction theorem begins, or you want to put RA, which one you want? RA you want? Okay, let us try. So, you have RA begins. Next, you have introduced the premise not L implies G and S. Okay, that is a premise. So, you get G and S by mode exponents. Next, use this. So, fourth one is you need G from this. So, 3 and tautology, which is elimination. Now, fifth is introduce that premise G if and only if not S and not L, it is a premise. Okay, you want to infer not S and not L from line 5. Okay, but not only line 5, you have to use G also there, right? So write 4 also. That is really mode exponents, because G if and only if not S and not L will give you G implies not S and not L, right. So, it is mode exponents. Now, from this you get not S elimination, then this one gives G and S, that gives S. So, 8 S 3 elimination. Okay, that gives what? Bottom. 7, 8, and this comes because of our extra assumption. Therefore, L you take 1, 10, RA ends. Now you have L. Next. L implies this?
So that is not G
and not S. Then it should give this, right? So 11, L implies not G and not S, that is a premise. 12, not G and not S from 10, 11 mode exponents. Okay. Next, that is a premise. Next, L, it is really mode exponents. Fine. So, equivalences can be used also for many other purposes. So, one of them, let us see how to bring some propositions to nicer form, from where we can guess better things. Okay. So, let us see one example, how does it go. Suppose I write one proposition in this form. Suppose I take this proposition. Now, can you tell me what are its models? See, a model means you are searching for one interpretation which makes the proposition true, right? it becomes one. Now it is an or proposition, everything is or together. So this becomes one when any one of them is one, right. So one avenue will give you this as one, another possibility one, another possibility this as one. Now this is one and proposition, it is a conjunction of many. So this can be one when all of them are one, right. So now we have three possibilities. So one possibility says P must be 1 and Q must be 1. In that case the proposition becomes 1, and the other possibility is when not Q is 1, R is 1. So you say Q is 0 and R is 1, okay. And there is another possibility when P is 1 and not S is 1. Okay. So these are the three possibilities you get looking at the proposition itself, and there is no other possibility when it becomes 1. Is that clear? Because it is R. Fine. Now from this, of course, you can find out so many others. Like you have now four propositional variables involved, but you have considered only two propositional variables. So other two are free. So free means they can be either 0 or 1, doesn't matter. Still this will be a model, right. So there will be four possibilities here when you give R as 1 or 0, S as 1 or 0. Similarly here there are again four possibilities, here also there are four possibilities, right. Yes. So you get all the models directly looking at the proposition, okay. So this is certainly a nicer form to get. Yes.
This we cannot get the number of.
No, you have to go further, right. You have to go further finding out all the possibilities, that will give you the number of models, fine. Now suppose I change the ors and ands here. Now I consider P or Q and not Q or R and P or not S. Keep everything else as it is. The same way you can find the non models of this, just think about it.